My guest today is a security expert from the Kofi Annan Peacekeeping Training Center. He's one of those professionals who is passionate about security. He's concerned and believes that in Ghana there are many, much more security challenges than we imagine. He says with the advent of oil and then in the last quarter of this year, this whole situation is going to get even more complicated, and he'd like us to begin to look at it more seriously. What are these threats, and what, in his opinion, are the best ways of dealing with them? Kwesi Aning, thank you for coming.
Well, thank you very much, David, for the invitation.
Kwesi, you are lecturing at the Kofi Annan Center for Peacekeeping Training. So I understand that that's an area that's important to you. Tell me, and I'd like to come back to exactly where you work, but first of all, what are those concerns that you, I hear you speak about quite a bit?
Well, I mean, there are multiple concerns, David. Multiple concerns with respect to the way that we understand security challenges in this country, the way that we resource those who have to respond to that challenge, and more importantly, the way in which we actually responding to those challenges. And the advent of oil and gas, unfortunately, has reflected and deepened what I've consistently called the naivety of our security thinking and response. Mm-hmm. That we've seen this offshore oil as the mantra to resolve all our economic problems. We've done actually very little to ensure that we protect that potential massive resource, and B, also to provide the logistics that will protect it and then to bring those monies into the coffers of the bank.
Protect it from who and what?
Well, protect it from a multiplicity of both old and new challenges. The old challenges are feeding on the new. The old are about small arms, issues of expectations, huge expectations, issues of chieftaincy, issues of the way that natural resources are allocated. The new will deal with oil bunkering. The new will deal with terrorism. The new will deal with issues related to maritime insecurity. We've got to ensure, and we've got to be bold and open-minded about this, that the potential for the money to come into this country will also attract some veritable bad nuts. And I think we've got to look at the counterfactual and begin to prepare before that oil comes on stream.
Where do we start?
We start by asking ourselves, what do we understand about what our factual challenges are, security challenges? We've got to ask ourselves, how do we resource those who are mandated by the state to respond? And we've got to ask ourselves, do we have the manpower? Do we have a fair process for recruitment, for training, and for advancement of career?
Do you think it deserves special treatment, security?
It's deserved more than enough special treatment for the past 40 years, but we haven't given it that special treatment. And we are beginning to see, David, that lack of ability to provide that special treatment.
Give me an example of where we are beginning to see that.
We are beginning to see that all over this country, where chieftaincy conflicts, land, youth
education. Is this not just something in the northern part of Ghana?
No. This cuts across the whole of this country. You see, one of the things that we've been very good at doing in this country is self-denial. We've created a false impression about ourselves.
That we are peaceful and peace-loving people.
That we are religious, that we are hospitable.
But that is true, is it not?
No, it's not. It's far from being true. That hospitality, that peacefulness, that myth about who we are as a single people has been shattered more than 30 years ago.
You're saying Ghanaians are not as peace-loving as they pretend to be.
I mean,
they're not as religious.
Peace-loving.
There's not one shop open on Sunday. Everybody is in church. They're in church even on weekdays.
It's business. It's big business. It's profitable. It puts a plaster on our sore. The rhetoric is fantastic. The singing and the dancing provides a legitimate avenue for people to enjoy themselves on Sunday.
Yeah.
Okay. But that veneer of religiosity is torn asunder very quickly when we leave the confines of the church. Okay. But I don't want this to make it part of the a discussion about the church, David. Yes, and I know I just want to preempt you before you say it.
I appreciate it. But it creates the context.
It creates the context within which we deceived ourselves.
That's what I mean.
That we are so peaceful that the budgetary allocations that should go to the security agencies and that nuance that should come into the way that they perform their work and the way that we expect them to perform and to engage them, it's just not there.
The security agencies need more resources?
Considerably more resources.
But that's one of the areas where they don't even have to explain how much money they get when they're putting a budget together. Am I not correct?
Well, they do put a budget together.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is they don't need to tell us what amounts they have. So I'm surprised. I would imagine they have as much as they want.
Well, the armed forces budget.
Yes, it's a secret.
Well, not that
not
much.
Not a secret? Okay.
No. It's only about 0.7% of GDP. Mm. That is terribly way below what we need. I mean, all our contiguous states, Togo, Burkina Faso, La Côte d'Ivoire, have about 1.2, 1.3.
Why is that? That's interesting that Ghana would be in that position.
Well, I think it's this conceptual framework, this idea
that we don't really have any real threats.
That we don't have any real external threats, and increasingly deceived ourselves that there were no internal threats also.
But there are no external threats.
There are.
Where are the external threats? Because Ivory Coast claims that the oil could be theirs. Is that why you suddenly see external threats?
That is just one of it.
Where else? Tell me.
The narcotics is a major threat to this country in terms of transportation, banking, potential infiltration of politics. Mm. Now, that is one of the most dangerous threats in this country.
What?
That our inability consistently to fight the narcotics threat eventually will lead to the capture of the state apparatus.
The political system, the judiciary and so on, you mean?
Yeah. I think there are more than enough indications.
That drug money can corrupt state institutions? Is that what you're saying?
That's what I'm saying.
And you say it's happening?
Well, if the Amwatin case is anything to go by, and the rhetoric that came on around the Amwatin case, and if you read the Hansard, one wonders whether those who were arguing in parliament about Amwatin captured in the Hansard, knew what they were talking about, or they wanted to throw dust into the eyes of the people of this country, one. Two, we know that one of the public agencies that I respect deeply, until recently was very badly deeply infiltrated, the Ghana Police Service. We also know that certain members of the judiciary have shown deep concern about some of the judgments related to narcotics. Okay, we know that both customs and immigration have had serious problems. Now, the way in which we've understood narcotics is that, well, this is just something that has started. This is a 50-year-old investment into the infrastructure of this country to enable the shift and the flow. So we've only not just become a transit point, we've also become a veritable redistribution point. Now, when you have an attempt at state capture, okay, albeit that the last 18 months or 24 months or so, as the conversations have come on board, we've sort of woken up to the potential threat. Mm. Now, and it took too long. And that is why, for me, we shouldn't wait too long to begin to realize the potential threats that the offshore oil also brings. Now, the master plan, the 208 master plan, has several sections dealing with security. And when you ask
which master plan for?
For the oil and gas sector.
Yeah, it has a section on security.
Yeah, it has a section on security that talks about providing a secure environment that will lead to the exploitation, the exploration, the transportation.
That's good.
That is good. Yeah. Oh, but we are fantastic with rhetoric.
Developing the plan.
Oh, we are, we are world class. I mean, if developing plans and providing the rhetoric was what would make us great,
we would be number one.
We would.